Church. Oh, there I am. It's good to be here with you on this beautiful, beautiful day. My name is James Connolly. I'm one of the pastors here at Emmanuel Church, and I just want to give a welcome to every single one of you. For our friends that are tuning in via live stream, I also want to welcome you this morning. We're glad to have you as well. So we have a few things, quite a bit of things coming up. So if you have a bulletin, hold that bulletin up. Let us see it. Make sure you read through those. Those are so important. It has tons of information. One thing I want to mention right off the bat is our Love Your Neighbor training that's coming up. That's going to be on April 13th from 9 to 2 p.m. Lunch is included, okay? And so the price for that is only $20, and it's well worth the price because you're going to get a Chick-fil-A meal with that, which is probably going to be a big chunk of that price. And then we're also going to have invaluable material. Now, this training, what it's so important about this training is we all know that what Jesus said the two greatest commandments were, right? The first was to love the Lord your God with all your heart, soul, mind, and strength. And then the second was what? Love your neighbors as yourself. Such an important command that Jesus gives us to love our neighbors. And yet so many of us, when it comes to literally our literal neighbors, those that live next door to us, we don't even know their names in many cases, or we don't have a deep relationship or connection with. And so I know for me, I felt so challenged in this when I sat through this very same seminar and training. And so I invited Jonathan Weibel to come here and Steve Lutz. They're both the two that have run the ministry Front Yard Mission. They're going to be with us that day to train us on what does this look like to love our neighbors, and how, and even coming up with creative ideas that we can begin to, first off, know our neighbors' names and be praying for them, but also build relationships and connections. So we strongly encourage you, if you are interested, you can register online for this at our church church website, and you can pay right through the website. The registration cost of $20 to be a part. You don't want to miss it, church family. This is truly one of the best seminars or trainings I've ever sat through. It was that good, and so you don't want to miss it. Want to mention also, it's that time of year, men's softball team. Let's hear it. Let's go. Okay. The men in the back. Yeah. You guys have the men's softball team have a meeting right there in the prayer room immediately following the service. And so if you are interested, men, if you're interested in being on this team or playing, or you just want to hear more, go to that meeting immediately following the service. Don't miss it. We also have some men's and women's studies that are starting this week. The women's Bible study will be starting on Monday at 6:30 p.m., and the men's connection group will start this Thursday at 7 p.m. So you men and women, you don't want to miss out on these opportunities to be able to connect with others in our church and to be able to grow deeper. And also, finally, just want to mention, this coming Saturday is our spring market event. We have over 40 vendors coming out for this event. That's more than double of last year's, which is awesome. And this event is a fundraiser to help raise funds for youth missions. So all the students that are going on missions trips this year, let's go. We've already raised almost $2,000 already just in registration fees, and I know that there's going to be incredible donations, and the youth are actually going to be selling some food and snacks and drinks, and we actually are in need of donated soups, like crock pots of soup donated for that event so that we can be able to provide soup as the lunch item. So if you're somebody that's like, I can make soup, I know, I make a mean soup. Let me know that you're interested in donating a crock pot of soup. We would greatly appreciate that. We already have a certain number, but we're trying, now that we've doubled in size of an event, we need more soup this year. So want to make mention of that to you. And just come out and be a part of getting to walk through and see all the different vendors that are a part of it next, again, this coming Saturday from 9 to 3, okay? So you don't want to miss on that. So, well, we're here to worship Jesus, amen? Amen. Will you stand with us as we go back into a time of worship?
Well, this morning as we enter into our worship time, I want you to think back to the day that you surrendered your life to Jesus. Think back to that day if you can remember it. The day that you said yes to him. The day that you gave your whole entire heart to him. Can you picture it? How did you feel? What was your response to him? I bet if you think back to that day, you were overwhelmed with joy and overwhelmed with a sense of what God did for you. We are entering into a season of remembering. If you can believe it, Good Friday and Easter is 2 weeks away. And I think I want to encourage us as a church to take some intentional time to remember what God did for us. What he did for us on the cross, the debt that he paid for us, that he loved you so much, that he died for you and gave you new life. And I think if we really take the time to reflect and remember what he did for us, that would cause us to worship him in a different way, to really celebrate what he did for us. 1 Peter 1:3 says, "Praise be to the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ. In his great mercy, he has given us new birth into a living hope through the resurrection of Jesus Christ from the dead." That's what Jesus did for you, and that's what he did for me. And that should cause us to worship him in a different way. The next song that we're going to sing is is an older song for a thousand tongues to sing. And if you know this song, it was written by a famous pastor named Charles Wesley. And he wrote this song to celebrate and commemorate the first anniversary of the day that he surrendered his life to Jesus. He wrote a song about it. And he was also inspired because of a friend of his that said this quote. He said, "Had I a thousand tongues, I would praise Christ Jesus with all of them." Let that sink in for a moment. Had I a thousand tongues, I would praise Christ Jesus with all of them. So this morning, as we go into our worship, let's raise our voices, let's raise our tongues, let's worship him, let's remember what he did for us, and let's give him praise and glory this morning.
the truth and life. You heal the deepest heart. You walked as love incarnate. You take what's wrong and make it right. So we lift our hands with every breath we praise you, Lord. Because we believe, Jesus, you're still the hope of the world.
Trust in the Lord with all of your heart and lean not on your own understanding. This word trust, I think, could be a little bit of a difficult word for us to wrestle with sometimes. This verse says to trust in the Lord with all of our heart, not some, not part, but all. As I was reflecting on this verse this week, I think the key part of putting all of our trust comes in the second part with this word lean. And as I was doing some study, I read this footnote this week that gave just a really good visual picture of what it looks like to lean. It says, leaning has the sense of putting your whole weight on something, resting on and trusting in the person or thing. Did you catch that? Your whole weight. I was thinking about the illustration of, say, you have a chair and you're tired and you want to rest your body. So what do? You don't sit in it, but you're leaning. And if you're leaning, you're putting your whole weight on it because you're trusting that that chair is going to hold you up. If you aren't leaning and trusting that's going to hold you up, then you're just merely touching it. But you're putting your weight into it. And I think the same is with Jesus. It says for us to lean not on our own understanding, not on ourselves, but we are to lean on Jesus. He's the one that we can trust. Because he is the one that is trustworthy. He is the one that is strong enough. He is the one that is big enough to lean into with everything. He can carry the weight. He can carry whatever we're carrying. He can carry whatever situation because he's big enough and he's strong enough. We just sung about what he did for us on the cross. He bore the entire weight of sin on that cross. He paid every single person's debt that we owe, and he did it for us. So he is trustworthy. He is strong enough, and he is big enough. So I just want to invite you into a space right here with the Lord. Just put yourself in a posture. If you want to sit, you can. If you want to stand. But you and the Lord, are there any areas in your life where you might be struggling to really trust him, to really lean on him? Take that to the Lord. Here's something else I want you to reflect on. Are there any people or things you've been leaning on instead of God? And it may not even be something big, it might be something tiny. Ask the Lord to show you that. Confess it to him. Right where you are, I just want you to reaffirm your trust in the Lord. If there's any pieces of your heart that you've taken back or any places where you've not been trusting him fully, give it back to him. Surrender it to him right now. In the same space, you can continue just to be with him. Whatever business you need to do with the Lord, don't rush past this. But we're just going to have some scripture being read over us. And as this scripture is being read, let that renew our heart and our mind and our soul and point us to worship the Lord because of who he is.
The Lord is my strength and my shield. My heart trusts in him, and he helps me. My heart leaps for joy, and with my song I praise him.
Find rest, O my soul, in God alone. My hope comes from him. He alone is my rock and my salvation. He is my fortress. I will not be shaken.
My salvation and my honor depend on God. He is my mighty rock, my refuge. Trust in him at all times, you people. Pour out your hearts to him, for God is our refuge.
This is the God that we worship. This is the God that we can put our trust, our hope in, because he's big enough and he's strong enough. So let's just continue to worship him, declaring to him that he is our hope, he is our trust. There's freedom to stand, to sit, but let's worship the Lord together here.
In the name of Jesus, all our worship, all our trust. In the name.
Oh, This is the song we will be singing for all of eternity. Holy is the Lord God Almighty, and worthy is the Lamb who was slain. The Lamb who purchased for himself peoples from all nations, tribes, and tongues. The Lamb who came to seek and save the lost. The Lamb who came to restore us who were broken and ripped away from the Father. You brought us back. And you are the only one who is holy, who is truly set apart, who is above all kings, kingdoms, all rulers. You are holy, God. Lord, we can lean our full weight on you, on this God, who reigns above the heavens and the earth, but who comes so close to us. Lord, you are so holy. You are so worthy. Lord Jesus, I thank you for the ways that you have pulled back the veil for us to behold you. I feel like this morning we got to behold you a little bit more. And Lord, I pray the rest of this morning and this day we would gaze at you and behold you and be transformed. As we look upon the Lamb who is worthy, as we look upon the Father who is holy, God, would you transform us to look more like you, to delight more in you, to be restored more unto you? Lord, you are moving among us this morning, and we know that, and we celebrate that, we love that, and we ask for more, Lord. So God, we thank you for the honor it is to worship you, to know you, to be loved by you, and the joy we will experience for all of eternity, looking on you fully, where our faith becomes our sight, and worshiping you, screaming, "Holy, holy, holy is the Lord God Almighty." We thank you, Lord. We worship you this morning. In Jesus' name I pray, amen. You may all be seated. And kids ages 5 through grade 5, you are dismissed at this time.
Easter is 2 weeks away from today. In your bulletins, there is a card. Yeah, can I grab that from you? Thank you. These are nice. They're smooth like butter. And we want these to be in your hands, not for your own sakes, because you guys already know that Easter's coming. You already know that the service will be at 10:30 on Easter morning and Friday night at what time? You guys already know these things, right? We don't need to tell you this again, though we will. We want you to put this in the hands of somebody who needs an invitation. There are people who this time of year are just kind of still wondering, still waiting, haven't really thought through what their Easter plans will be. There's people who have some church in their background but don't really actively go anywhere and are just waiting for someone to invite them. They may not realize it, but if they get that invitation, they might go, huh, yeah, I'll come with you. And so we want to get these in the hands of people, not so that we can just like fill our room bigger, though Easter Sunday it's always very full, come early. We want this to be so that people have an opportunity to hear the good news of Jesus Christ. Friday night, we're going to be having a service in here at 6:30. It'll be communion. It'll be interactive. It'll be focusing on the cross. It'll be a time, just even for 1 hour, that we reflect on the depth and meaning of Christ's sacrifice for us. And so we want you to come out Friday night. Sunday morning is going to be a time where at 10 a.m. we're going to have coffee, like specialty coffees. We're going to have donuts. We're going to have like a regular old family hangout time on Easter Sunday morning. We want to fill this place up with people so we can celebrate what Christ did and we can hear the good news. That the theme is on believe, that in John chapter 20, you have Thomas, who we know as, what's his nickname? Doubting Thomas. But when he saw the Lord Jesus Christ, that doubt was erased. And we're going to look at the arguments for the resurrection of Jesus Christ. And it's a good message for us to hear, and it's a good message for people who are still kind of just in that wondering, seeking kind of place, what does this all mean? So Easter weekend, it's going to be a huge time for our church family, so make sure that you get that on your calendar and be inviting people. All the information, too, is on our website if people go there. Go ahead and open up your Bibles this morning to 1 Thessalonians chapter 2. We're going to finish chapter 2, and we're getting into chapter 3 today. I'm excited to look at this with you. And as you're turning there, kind of keep your finger there if you've got your paperback Bible, which I prefer. If you like digital version, keep it there. Don't let the screen die. You know, keep it going. We're going to come back to it. But first, I want to tell you a story that I was reading this week, a fascinating story that captured my attention, and it will foreshadow what's going on in the text here today. Back in 1858, this is a century and a half ago, a Scottish missionary by the name of John Peyton and his young wife, check out his beard, that's, wow, they did great beards back then. I don't know if I would do that. A lot gets caught in that beard. He and his young bride and his infant son sailed from Scotland to the Hebrides Islands that are 2,000 miles off the coast of Australia. He was a missionary, and he and his wife, they were sent. They went to these islands, and they served there. Now, these islands had a not-so-good reputation. They were spiritually dark. They were very resistant to any outsiders, let alone to missionaries. They had killed missionaries, robbed missionaries, beaten them up, intimidated them in so many ways. This culture had a practice of human sacrifice and of cannibalism too. And so as he was preparing to go, John Peyton and several of his friends and family spoke in his life, don't go there. It's too dangerous. The stories had come out of there and were spilling around the world how hard this was of a place to reach. In fact, he had an older friend who said to him, if you go, you guys are going to be eaten by cannibals. Don't go there. And this was his response. I love this. And the older man's name was Mr. Dixon. He says, Mr. Dixon, you are advanced in years now, and your own prospect is soon to be laid in the grave, there to be eaten by worms. I confess to you that if I can but live and die serving the Lord Jesus Christ, it will make no difference to me whether I'm eaten by cannibals or eaten by worms. And in the great day, my resurrection body will rise as fair as yours in the likeness of our risen Redeemer. This guy was not going to be deterred from his mission. He was going to go no matter what. He had a heart of love for Jesus Christ. He had a heart of love for the church, for his mission, that all people would get to hear of the good news of Jesus Christ. And so he and his wife sailed for these islands. So how did it turn out? After being there for only 3 months, his young wife passed away from sickness, from fever. 3 weeks later, their infant son died. And what did John Peyton do? Well, for a while, he left the islands and grieved and regathered himself and gathered support, even in the time that he was away, met and married a new wife. And she was as committed to this as his first wife was. And they went back to the islands. And they served there for 41 years, had 10 kids, planted churches, spread the good news of Jesus Christ. It's an amazing story. Talk about a man with convictions. He loved Jesus, he loved the church, loved the mission, was not going to be stopped for anything. And it reminds me of another person we see in Scripture who we've been talking about a lot as we're going through 1 Thessalonians. Who is that person? Paul, the Apostle Paul. He loved Jesus Christ. He was deeply committed to the mission and to the church, to pouring into people's lives. And he was not going to be stopped no matter what happened as well. You know, if we could have only a slice of the heart that they had, think of what God could do through us. If we only had half of that commitment. And today we're going to see in our passage in 1 Thessalonians that the heart of Paul just come bleeding through the pages of the passage we're about to read. His heart was for the people of Thessalonica. His heart was almost, in a sense, being torn out from him, because you're going to hear the language of how personal, how painful it was, the situation that was going on. In fact, I kind of have this image in my mind of like a lemon that you're squeezing and the juice comes out. That's kind of like what's happening with Paul. And we're going to see like the missional truths that he had in his heart come pouring out. I couldn't call the message Heart of Lemon. That would have sounded kind of weird. So I called it Heart of Gold. And we're going to see Paul's Heart of Gold. And maybe we'll call the truths that come out like little gold flakes or gold nuggets that are being squeezed out of him. So follow along as I read, starting chapter 2, verse 17. It says, "But brothers, when we were torn away from you for a short time, in person, not in thought," in other words, you've been on our hearts, you've been on our minds this whole time, "out of our intense longing, we made every effort to see you. For we wanted to come to you, certainly I, Paul, did, again and again. But Satan stopped us. For what is our hope, our joy, or the crown in which we will glory?" Most translations say our crown of boasting in the Lord, in the presence of our Lord Jesus Christ when he comes. "Is it not you? Indeed, you are our glory and joy. So when we could stand it no longer, we thought it best to be left by ourselves in Athens, and we sent Timothy, who was our brother and God's fellow worker in spreading the gospel of Christ, to strengthen and encourage you in your faith, so that no one would be unsettled by these trials. You know quite well that we were destined for them. In fact, when we were with you, we kept telling you that we would be persecuted, and it turned out that way, as you well know. For this reason, when I could stand it no longer, I sent to find out about your faith. I was afraid that in some way the tempter might have tempted you and our efforts might have been useless." Whew. Do you hear it? It's like that lemon being squeezed and his heart was almost in a way tortured for the absence he had away from these Thessalonians as they were going through difficulties, as he was going through difficulties. And there are six things we're going to look at this morning. I don't know how else to organize this message because there's so many things in here. And one of these things, at least, might be for you, that we look at, that we see coming from Paul's heart. The first one of those things, the first gold nugget we see in verses 17 and 18, that when you love God, you love his church. And when you love his church, you love the people of that church. The people that you have begun to form relationships with, people you have begun to pour into. He says this language in here, "But brothers, when we were torn away from you," and we're going to talk about what does that mean? Paul and his team were torn away from him after such a short time, in person, not in thought. "Out of our intense longing, we made every effort to see you, for we wanted to come to you. Certainly I, Paul, did, again and again." There's this, this desire Paul had to see them, to be with them. You could tell it wasn't just a professional job for Paul. He wasn't just doing this to somehow collect a paycheck, which he wasn't even collecting a paycheck. He was earning his own paycheck along the way and serving these people. But you could tell his life was invested here. His heart was in for these people. If you remember a couple weeks ago, the background behind this, Paul and Silas and Timothy had come to this region. This is in northern Greece, and they come to the city of Thessalonica. They were the first ones to ever tell anyone in that city about Jesus Christ. They were the ones that got the privilege to introduce them to who Jesus is, and after several weeks, 50, 60, 80 people began to put their faith in Jesus, and these baby Christians, this baby church had formed. And we know it was at least 6 weeks, and it might have been as much as 3 months, but it wasn't that long he was with them. And then they had to leave overnight because of persecution, because there were people that wanted to take his life. It was the Jews there were jealous of Paul and wanted to stomp out this thing called Christianity. And so they had to whisk him out of town, Paul and Silas and Timothy, get them away. And here's the map that can help you visualize what this is like. So you see Thessalonica, it's near the top there, the northern part of the peninsula of Greece. And they had to get down to Berea. That was the next town away. It was 45 miles to get down to Berea over land. Eventually, you're gonna hear them talk about other cities, so just kind of getting this in your mind. They went down to Athens. It doesn't refer to Corinth, but that's the next place that they were going to go to, and actually had an incredible long ministry in Corinth. But this is what Paul's talking about. We wanted to come back to you guys, but we couldn't. We were stopped from doing that. In Acts chapter 17, we can read about this whole story. It's the story behind all these letters. And Paul and Silas and Timothy were down in Berea next, and they were able to plant a church there, and it was awesome. And those people were very receptive, studying the word with them. And then they got chased out of there too, or at least Paul did, and had to go down to Athens. So in Paul's mind, in Paul's heart, he's thinking, I need to go back up to Thessalonica and see if these people are okay. I mean, if people are chasing me out of the town and they don't want this Christianity thing to go on, then are they going to make it? Because surely they're facing persecution. Surely the people want to stop their faith. And it's difficult. And Paul is feeling that tension that I want to be with them in person because I care about them. I want to build them up. I want to check on how they're doing. Do you guys realize that this past week was the 4-year anniversary of the COVID-19 shutdown? March 13th. I'll never forget the date. I don't know what it was like for you guys, but I know for me it was a Friday. Kind of back up a little bit. We had just come back from a missions trip to Cambodia. We were halfway around the world, me and a team of, I think it was 6 that went on this trip, and we're flying back on the plane, and people are coughing and sneezing, and we're hearing about this thing called COVID, and we're like, what? What is this? Like, they never shut things down. There's not really a lot to worry about, right? And we got back, and I was okay. I think a couple of our team members got pretty sick, right, Mike? You were down for the count for like a week. He was already off for a missions trip. He comes home, he can't even work, and we don't know if that was COVID or not, but we kind of got back into the routine. I had one Sunday with the church, got back, was able to preach and kind of share about the trip a little bit. We had a night planned for our whole team to share about our trip to Cambodia. And then we moved into the next week, and I'm sermon planning. We're getting ready for the next Sunday, and we're hearing more about what's going on with COVID. And someone asked me, another person from another church, he goes, are you guys doing anything for this COVID thing? He goes, we're going to put some hand sanitizer stations out, but I think, you know, we're going to just move forward as normal. I was like, yeah, we're going to move forward as normal. Like, why would we shut anything down? And then we're hearing, like, stores are closing, schools are closing, everything in the country is closing. And then they put the request out to ask everyone to just stop what you're doing for 2 weeks to what? Flatten the curve. Uh-huh. And you know, 2 weeks. Okay, 2 weeks. And then it turned into months. And you guys remember the whole story. It was like, ugh. That was the hardest season I've ever been through as a pastor. I'm telling you, I've been in ministry for 20-some years, almost 25 years. And that season was so difficult. politically, all the opinions about different things, and what does the church do and in relation to government, and like all the stuff that was going on. And one of the hardest things about it was, here we were a church family that was meeting on Sundays regularly, small groups, ministries we were doing as a church, all this stuff, and immediately it shuts down. And you think, okay, that'll just be for a short time. But then it turns into months. And then when we are able to regather, there are people who didn't feel comfortable coming back. No passing, no judgment on that, but everyone had to make their choices. And we did start regathering, and we had like half of our people. And when we were gathering, you had to stay 6 feet apart, and you had to wear masks. And like, you guys remember how hard that was. Relationally, as a pastor, I'm going, okay, 2 months, 3 months, 4 months, like, are our people okay? Like, we were checking on you guys. We were, you know, connecting as best we could. We did a little drive-up thing in the front. Remember we did that where you could, like, drop off goods for our food drive, drop off your offering. You could pick up a communion cup. We could pray for you through the window. We couldn't touch you, but we were like, hey, we're going to pray for you. Okay, let's pray right now. And, you know, put their masks on. And we did the best we could. But I remember, like, is our church slipping away? Like, are people going to hang in with Jesus, let alone with our church through this time? And I'm not unique in this to say that our church lost a quarter of our people through COVID. It was tough. Extend that now to a year or two afterwards. We lost a quarter of our people, and so did every other church. And gained people back, and that's great. But I remember this thought of like, this is not okay. Like, spiritually, we've got to be together. Like, I want to see the people. I want to be able to pray with them. I want to be able to worship the Lord with them. I want to not be preaching to a camera. I am preaching to a camera this morning. Thanks for joining us on live stream. It's a good thing we've had. It's a nice addition, but it's not how we're meant to be long term, right? We're meant to be together. There's something different about it, and I just want to celebrate that today, that we have that opportunity, and just say, don't take it for granted. Remember what it was like. And this is what Paul's saying. There's something about us being together, and my heart gets ripped out when we can't. We've got to value this idea of family, loving God's people together. That's the first nugget I see in here, and we're going to kind of weave back into that here in a minute. But there's something that pops up at the end of verse 18 that kind of stops me in my tracks. I don't know about you guys. He says, we wanted to come to you, certainly I, Paul, did again and again, but Satan stopped us or thwarted us or wouldn't let us. That's a head scratcher. And you might even see the point that I've got on here is God redirects our best intended plans. This says Satan stopped us. So Satan can stop the Apostle Paul from what he was wanting to do? What, did he not pray hard enough? Did he pray and then God just wasn't listening? Or God doesn't have the ability to overcome what Satan's plans are against us? What's really happening here? God was allowing something to be happening that God knew was better, that Satan was throwing a plan in, but God was going to do a little ninja move and make it something that was for his glory. That's what was happening. And he can do that in your life, and he can do that in mine. Let's explain what that is here, what Paul's talking about. Why was he being stopped from seeing these Thessalonians? Well, you know that Paul was chased out of the city of Thessalonica by the Jewish contingency there that was against Christianity, was against Paul, wanted to get him out of town. They ran Paul out of the city in Thessalonica. They went to Berea. We'll go ahead and put the map back up here. They went to Berea, and they got chased out of Berea. At least Paul did. He had to hightail it down to Athens. The people of Berea snuck him out at night again in the midst of a life-threatening situation, put him on a boat, and he went down to Athens. That's why that red line kind of goes out in the water and down to Athens. That's 150 miles down to Athens. Who chased him out of Berea? Not the Bereans. It was the Jews from Thessalonica took the 45-mile trip down to Berea, stirred up the city, and chased Paul out of there. It was the Thessalonians that were so mad. And Paul knew, if I step foot in Berea, even if I stay there, like, my life's in danger. How in the world could I ever go back up to Thessalonica? They have it in for me. I cannot even go back to that city. He had a target on his back. And so he says, I tried many times. We were trying to figure out, strategize, scheme. How can I get up there to Thessalonica? But I just knew if I went, it's death for me. And it just wasn't the right time. Maybe as he was praying, didn't have freedom from the Lord. Hey, I'm going to protect you if you go back there. But no, he knew he could not go back to Thessalonica. Satan stopped him. How does he know it was Satan? I mean, how do we know if a door slams in our face, is it God slamming the door? Is it Satan slamming the door? And if it's Satan, shouldn't I be knocking all the more and praying, God, would you open this door? And I'm sure Paul and Silas and Timothy prayed many, many times. God, will you open the door for us to get back there? But it never reopened. How do we know this case it was Satan? I think because it's the nature of what prevented him from being there was persecution. Certainly, it wasn't God stirring up these people to do violence to keep Paul out. It was born of Satan. He's the one who wanted to stop things. He's the one who wanted to shut things down there. But God didn't squash it. God had bigger plans. Paul's best intended plan to get back to Thessalonica, God said, nope, I'm actually going to keep you moving along down the road. You're going to Berea. There was a great ministry there. And then you're moving on down to Athens. And Paul had an incredible ministry there. We can read about it in Acts 17. It's one of the most famous passages where Paul was in the very center of Greek philosophy and influence. He's able to go into the Acropolis where they have all these booths set up to talk about their philosophies. And Paul comes in and is able to share the gospel in a direct and creative way. And the whole place listens to him. They invite him to come back. And there's people who come to faith in Christ right in the former capital of the Greek Empire. God used him right there. It was an incredible thing. And then he moves on to Corinth, and there's an incredible ministry that opens up for a year and a half for Paul to do ministry there. God wanted to move him down the road. And he said, Paul, it's not for you to go back to Thessalonica. You can't just hold their hand. You can't be with them forever. You need to move along. And God has that ability in our lives to shut certain doors, and even if Satan shuts them, God may not reopen them. We need to ask. We need to pray into that. But if God decides not to reopen that door, we got to go, okay, God, I'm going to trust you. I'm going to trust you with all my life, like we were just talking about today, singing about. And I'm going to trust that your plans are more sovereign than my plans. Has anyone had that happen before where you want to go this way, you think it's God's will, and he goes and moves you over here? And there's just a part of surrendering to him in that. I mean, think of what happened to John Payton. Here he was trying to go to this island of what's now we now know as Vanuatu, I can't remember how to say this, Hebrides Islands, and his wife dies, and his son dies, and he's like, God, I'm serving you, but then this happens, and he leaves, and God had a plan in mind. He knew what he was doing. I'll share a little bit more about that story later on, but are we open, even if it means suffering, even if it means difficulty, for God to redirect us according to how he sees fit, even if it's painful? That's the next nugget we get from the Apostle Paul. The one after that, coming up next, is verses 19 and 20. And this is like some strong language here of hope and of excitement. He says, for what is our hope? Our joy, or the crown in which we will glory in the presence of our Lord Jesus when he comes. Is it not you? Indeed, you are our glory and joy. He says, these people, these Thessalonians, are his glory and his joy. He's got like a crown of boasting. When Jesus comes back, like, Jesus, check this out. What does this mean? Has Paul gone crazy here? Has he gone off his rocker? Because we know a couple things that this needs to reconcile with. First of all, isn't Jesus himself our glory and our joy? Isn't he our hope? Paul says that over and over again in Scripture. So somehow this has to balance with that, right? Jesus is all we need. Jesus is the one we trust in. It's not in people. That's not what he's saying. Secondly, when Jesus comes back, isn't our hope to just get to see him face to face, and we know that we're going to be accepted into his presence and into heaven because of what he has done, not what we do? Jesus has died on the cross. He has shed his blood for our sin, and his blood covers all of our sin. And if you're confused about that at all today, let me just make clear. There's not a person who will get into heaven by something good that they have done. It's only by Jesus Christ dying for us, putting our faith in him, our trust in him. We're saved by grace through faith alone. That's clear in Scripture. It's not what Paul's getting confused about here. He's not getting confused. He's not mixing that up. What he's saying is, when I see Jesus, I want to have something to give him. That's my glory, my joy, to give him something that I can worship him with. He's not boasting in himself. He's boasting in Jesus, you've done all this for me. You've given me this life, and now here I've got this crown to lay at your feet. What we find out in Scripture is that when we do get to heaven, whether it's when Jesus comes back, if we're still alive at that time, or when we die, we know that we go and we're instantly in the presence of the Lord. To be absent from the body is to be present with the Lord, it says in 2 Corinthians chapter 5. So we get to be right in his presence. Now, we have a judgment against our lives, against our sinfulness, and we know that we only get in by the blood of Jesus. That we've trusted in him and what he has done for us. But there's another kind of judgment of kind of weighing out our life. Whatever we built our lives upon with the grace of God we were given, what did we do with that? In 1 Corinthians 3, it talks about how there's going to almost be like a fire that's going to go through the material of our life. If we built our lives with wood, hay, and straw, it's going to burn up and there's going to be nothing left for us. But it says if we build our lives with precious metals, gold and silver, and with precious stones, and the fire comes and kind of reveals what we have placed our trust in, what we've done with our time, what we've done with our lives, and it lasts through the fire, then we've got something of value to worship the Lord with. And so here's the question: what are you and I building our life with? That we could, at the end of all time, be able to put before Jesus as he says, "Well done, my good and faithful servant." We go, "No, it was all about you. My life was about you, and my heart was after the things that matter to you." And what does he care most about? It's the souls of people. Have we poured into other people? Have we shared the gospel with people? Have we discipled people? Have we mentored people in the faith and helped to raise them up in the faith? That's what's going to matter. They say there's no U-Hauls behind hearses. You can't take your stuff with you. But what's eternal? Souls. Have we invested in things that matter? And Paul's saying, when I see Jesus, and you guys, you're going to be ones that I go, "Look, Jesus, look what you did in their lives, and you used me to be part of that, and I just lay that at your feet. You were so gracious to use me." That's my glory. That's my hope. That's my joy, to be able to worship Jesus. What are you building your life with? What is the aim of your life? What are your priorities? What's your joy, your glory? Let the Apostle Paul's words here, as he speaks with the inspiration of the Holy Spirit, let that sift out your heart motives. Then we get our next gold nugget. We go into chapter 3. That's a big marker. Hey, we've gone into another chapter now, and we're moving forward in the book of 1 Thessalonians. And the first two verses, we start to see what Paul did as a solution. His heart's torn. He's saying, "I got to see you guys," but he knows he can't. So he says, "When we could stand it no longer, we thought it best to be left by ourselves in Athens, and we sent Timothy, who is our brother and God's fellow worker in spreading the gospel of Christ, to strengthen and encourage you in your faith." So the solution was, we're going to send Timothy, and he's going to go strengthen and encourage you. So the reality here is people need strengthening and people need encouraging. Do you need that in your life? Do you need strengthening and encouraging from other people? It's a commonly known fact. Paul knows that they need it. And I just want to explore that for a minute. We need strengthening and encouragement in our walk with God. We'll put the map back up for a second. Paul knew this baby church was facing an uphill battle, so he sent Timothy. So from Berea, Timothy and Silas, best as I can figure out from Acts chapter 17, they came down to Athens, and Paul says here, we thought it best to be left by ourselves and send Timothy to go up to Thessalonica. Side little bar here. This is cool. Timothy, this was his first assignment he did on his own. Paul had picked him up to come along with him when they were in what's known as modern-day Turkey, much more to the east, and had traveled with Paul now through Turkey, then all these churches, and he had assignments with Paul and was doing ministry with him. But this is his first thing he was ever sent to do by himself. And Timothy proved himself. He did a great job with this mission to strengthen and encourage the Thessalonians. And I just want to note, this is multiplication. This is Paul having a heart to want to pour into other people and for them to kind of take the baton and go forward with it. And we need to be doing that in our ministries and in our lives here. We need to be like a Paul to a Timothy, helping them get going in what they're doing in their faith. Back to the main point, though. Timothy gets to go to Thessalonica. Now, how does Timothy get to go there and Paul couldn't? Well, Timothy was a little more under the radar. He was young. He probably, wore a hoodie. No, I don't know what he wore. Sunglasses. He's coming into town. They don't really recognize him. He wasn't quite as visible as Paul. He didn't have the same personality, the same face. They knew Paul's face. They might not have known Timothy's face because he was kind of off to the side. And he's able to get into Thessalonica. Now, there were no phone calls back then, no texts. They couldn't tell the Thessalonians, hey, Timothy's coming, watch out for him. There's no Live 360 app. Oh, Timothy's coming up here. What's he doing? He shows up, probably knocks on someone's door at nightfall, like to kind of be hidden. One of the believers there, hey, let me in. It's Timothy. Timothy, what are you doing here? Open the door. Great to see you. Come on inside. Shh, shh, shh. Don't let anyone know you're here. And Timothy begins to encourage them. They probably said, hey, we're going to gather everybody together. This is great news. Timothy, we haven't seen you in months now. You guys got to Berea, then you went down to Athens. Are you guys okay? We heard about all the persecution that's coming. People were leaving our city, going down to Berea and chasing you guys out. We thought you guys were going to be goners, but is everybody okay? Yeah, they're all okay. And Timothy gets to encourage them, tell them the stories, and pray with them, and help build them up, and do some teaching with the gathering of believers there. And he knocked it out of the park. Sometimes people need that encouragement of a Timothy showing up alongside them. And that's what the word actually means there, to encourage, is to come alongside and build them up. There are people in this church family that need strengthening and encouraging. In fact, that used to be one of the strengths of our church. I'm gonna bring up COVID again. Pre-COVID, it was a strength we had had for a really long time, and COVID kind of shook that up because you didn't see people for a while, and then now there's been a whole lot of changeover, people who left during that time, and we've got newer people. If you're new to our church in the last, 3 years, put your hand up. Just kind of get the sense. Yeah, that's good. There's a lot of changeover that's happened, and I rejoice in that. But our church body needs to kind of continue to work hard at regelling together, right? That we've got strengthening bonds and encouraging bonds happening within our body. So here's something I want to throw to you. You may have ways that you strengthen and encourage people, and if you're part of Bible studies, if you're serving on ministry teams, or whatever you're part of in the church, and that's the fabric of our church. But on Sunday mornings, people generally sit in the same area, right? You got your overflow people. You got your front row people. Wisers, I see you guys there all the time, right? Second row people, it's okay. I like that. You got your right side people who like the light of the windows over here, and you got your people in the back, and they always sit in the back, right? Here's what I want to encourage you to do. Put that radar out to see who's in your area. And when you see somebody who's newer, make it a point. Go meet them. Get their name down. So that the next week, you can even like write their name down. So you can call them by name the next week. When you talk to somebody in your area and you go, okay, so what? How's your week going? Well, yeah, not so good. I had this and this going on. And then kind of make a mental note. I want to reach out to them this week sometime in the middle of the week. Follow up on them. Or next Sunday, I'm going to ask them how they're doing about that. Maybe take a minute to pray with them, just person to person, right there, and just encourage them. These are simple things, little things that we could do to own our little areas where we sit and build those bonds of strengthening and encouragement. I want to challenge you that every week you come to church, put this in your mind. I want to strengthen somebody. I want to encourage somebody. Maybe you're the one who feels like, I need this week. But Lord, I want to at least fulfill that assignment. I want to do one thing to build somebody else up. And I'm hoping somebody else will build me up. That means you got to share about it if somebody asks you. But let's be a church that gets strong in this again. This is one of our strengths, that we're a family together that watches out for each other, because heaven knows we need it. Life is hard. It's difficult. We need some Timothys to be encouragers and strengtheners in our church family. Next one kind of reveals why. Why do we need this? Verses 3 and 4, kind of back up a little bit into chapter 2, that he sent Timothy to strengthen and encourage you in your faith. Verse 3, so that no one would be unsettled or kind of shaken loose by these trials. You know quite well that we were destined for them. In fact, when we were with you, we kept telling you that we would be persecuted, and it turned out that way. As you well know, there were trials and difficulties coming because of all of this that Paul's talking about. They had to leave one town, then they have to leave another town, and then the hornet's nest keeps getting stirred up there in Thessalonica. And Paul knows. He's like, we told you guys, it's not going to be easy. So we want to make sure that you know persecution, trials, they're gonna come to all of us. He says, we were destined for them. Let's get it in our minds. Jesus never promised that coming to faith in him means all of our problems are going to go away. He never promised that. Now, some of our problems go away because as we start following Jesus and following his word, the dumb decisions we used to make that kept sabotaging our lives, those do kind of get resolved as he works in us and his spirit guides us and we lead our lives with more wisdom and in his grace, right? We also know that he's with us in all of our trials and tribulations. He's going to walk with us through the valley of the shadow of death. And so it's not the same as it used to be. And we also know we're looking forward to a day when we're going to go to be with him forever, and there will be no more trials or difficulties or pain or anything like that. He has promised that. But he says, in this life, you will have trouble. Fear not, I've overcome the world, but you will have trouble. And so we need to kind of grapple with this and realize that as we are following Jesus, there's going to be people who don't like it. They don't like the fact that we're followers of Jesus. There's going to be people who take advantage of us. There's going to be people who make fun of us. There's going to be people who test our patience or test our character. There's going to be people who might outright hate us. I mean, Jesus was following the will of the Father, and he was crucified for it. Right? So if even Jesus faced this, then so are we. But on top of that, Satan doesn't like us to be following Jesus either. We talked about this last week. It puts a target on our back. And Satan, the more that we follow him, the more serious we are about surrendering our life and taking risks to follow him and worshiping the Lord, the more he's going to come after us. If you want to have more peace with Satan, kind of be lulled to sleep in his little grasp, then just kind of relax and don't try to fight. And he's going to have his grip on you, and he'll just say, hush, little baby, go to sleep. But if you want to get out of his grasp and you want to be following Jesus, he's going to want to hang on to you, come after you. So persecution, trials will come. Yes, we can pray against it. Yes, we can stand with our armor on, not giving in to his temptations and schemes, But God doesn't always free us from that, as we saw earlier. He allows hard things to come into our lives. Paul had reconciled himself with that. He said, I know this is just what's going to happen. I told you guys it's going to happen, and it's playing out that way. Like, difficulties are coming into our lives. Paul himself was almost killed several times. He's now stuck two cities away from the people he wanted to be reaching. He almost got killed several times, and more was coming in his future. Does that discourage you? Does that make you kind of go, I don't know if I want to keep going in this thing called faith in Jesus? Let me tell you the good side of this. Jesus has promised never to leave us or forsake us. He has promised he's going to walk with us in the midst of the worst things that we go through. He's promised that we're actually laying up treasure in heaven. We're laying up, we're storing our lives into the things that matter and not the things that don't matter. If you're going to invest in terms of what really matters, do you want to invest in this little slice of time that you're living on earth and live for this? Or do you want to live for eternity that starts here and goes on forever and ever and ever? Where do you want to invest your life in? There's a time coming when the eternal things are going to be revealed, and we're going to be able to just rejoice that we lived for Jesus, that we trusted him, that we built our lives upon what was eternal, not the things that are temporary. That promise stands, and it's going to be wonderful forever. He said we can even count it pure joy when we face trials of many kinds. Why? Because he's working in us. And I want to put that promise up from John 16:33. I have told you these things so that in me you may have peace. In this world you will have trouble, but take heart. I have overcome the world. The troubles you're facing right now, Jesus has already overcome them. We don't experience always the victory until it could be now, but it might be later, deferred to another time. He says, take heart. Keep trusting. Keep going, because I am with you. So if you're facing difficulty, if it's a sacrifice right now to be following Jesus, he's with you. It's worth it. Keep going, Paul would say. Jesus has promised good things for you. And then we come to the sixth little piece we see from Paul's heart here. And that's this. Find it in verse 5. Satan can make some people fall away. Sometimes that persecution, that those trials, those difficulties get so intense that there are people who fall away. And I thought it was worth at least just stating here, because the Apostle Paul is wrestling with that reality. That he's carrying a weight on him, wondering if the Thessalonians were going to make it or not. He says these very words. For this reason, when I could stand it no longer, I sent to find out about your faith. I was afraid that in some way the tempter, who's that? Satan, might have tempted you and our efforts might have been useless. Now, I'm not going to get into, does this mean that people who are saved and become unsaved or that they were never saved in the first place? And there's a whole theological Pandora's box we could get into about all of that. I'm not going to go in that direction. This verse is hard for me, not because of necessarily what I see theologically. It's hard for me from what I see practically. You've met people. You've known people. I've known people who have been walking with the Lord or appeared to be walking with the Lord and then fall away. I mean, I have two cousins in mind. As I was preparing, I'm like, yeah, that sits on me. My uncle, I've told you guys the story about my uncle who was a missionary. He's fallen away. I was a youth pastor for many years and invested in a whole lot of students, and some students carried on with their faith in the Lord and are following him still today. Some are leaders in the church, and you're just like, yes. And then you've got ones that you're like, you showed so much promise. You were growing, and then just, poof, they've gone away. I've been in discipleship ministry and have been a lead pastor long enough to see dozens and dozens of people fall away in their faith. People who get tempted by the world, or people who fall into this thing of deconstructing and questioning everything, and they tear it all apart and never build it back up on any sort of solid truth, and their faith is gone. It's just, it's heartbreaking. You've you've probably experienced the pain of this too. And so that's why it's critical that we kind of do what number four said, that we're going to strengthen people and encourage people and do this thing together, be that family that it's calling us to be here, and that we pour into people's lives. We need to stay as faithful to do that as possible. And yet there's the reality we have to face that sometimes no matter what we do, people are still going to fall away, and it's not our fault. They just fall to Satan's schemes. That's hard. That's heavy. But let's not let that have us give up. Let's not let that have us shrink away. Paul was saying, this stinks. My heart's being ripped out because I don't know what's going to happen. Listen, if your heart's being ripped out for somebody, it's not a bad thing. Keep loving Jesus and keep loving his church. And by your heart being torn, it shows that you actually care. It shows that you actually do trust him, that you are following after him. And it's worth sometimes having your heart broken for the sake of pouring into other people. Now let me circle back to the story of John Payton, the missionary. Because sometimes there's really cool endings to stories. John Payton, you know, grieved. He had paid a high cost when his first wife died and his son died. And I can't imagine what that was like for him. What am I supposed to do? Questioning everything, questioning his calling. And yet he fell back on Jesus and he restored that call in his life. And he said, I'm going to go back. The very fact that he went back was the game changer for those people. They couldn't believe he would come back. They thought, hey, we scored another victory. We got another one gone. This is what he found out years later that they were thinking in their minds. He says, we slew them or drove them all away. We plundered their houses and robbed them. Had we been so treated, nothing would have made us return. But they come back in a beautiful new ship and with more and more missionaries. And is it to trade and get money like the other white men? No. But to tell us of their Jehovah God and of his son Jesus. If their God makes them do all that, we may well worship them too. Worship him too. And today, get this, more than 80% of the inhabitants of Vanuatu, these islands, are Christians, largely due to the ministry of John Payton. In fact, the island that he was on is, as best you can say, completely a believing island in Jesus Christ. Several of his kids became missionaries there. In fact, one of his sons helped him translate the Bible into their language. And there have been four generations in his family to minister in that place. What kind of heart do we have for Jesus and his church? John Payton had a heart of gold. The Apostle Paul had a heart of gold. If we could just catch a little bit of that from the Lord today, imagine what he could do through us. I want to put these six things back up on the screen. We'll just conclude with this. Is there one that he's kind of tugged on you for? You know, this was for me today. Just identify one of those, two of those. I'm going to give you just a chance to pray here in a moment. All right, talk it over with Jesus. What is he saying to you? Lord, will you give us a renewed passion today for you and a renewed passion then for people you love, that we would keep going forward to reach more, to invest in more, to strengthen more, so that we would stay walking together as a family, faithful, trusting you even through the trials and persecutions and difficulties of life until that day you return. And we look forward to seeing you face to face. And we'll just echo the cry at the end of Revelation 20. Come, Lord Jesus, come. Come quickly. We worship you. It's our life's aim is that we would glorify your name. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Amen. God bless you. Have a wonderful day. Enjoy the sunshine. We'll see you back next week.